forum underway as well as we speak. So you are very loyal participants. But this is a particularly delightful morning for us working with Peter Juven here. The Wilson Center, of course, as you know, is the official monument to Woodrow Wilson as president. It was established by Congress in 68, and we're here to try to bring the world of ideas and policy together. We're having Peter speak about his not-so-new book now, the book that was released in the last year, On Burundi, A Life After Violence. Peter, as you probably all know, is the Henry J. Lear Chair of International Humanitarian Studies and Director of the Institute for Human Security at Fletcher School of Law at Tufts. But he's a storied and legendary practitioner in the field and worked in Rwanda and Burundi and other places in Africa. We've been closely associated with him over the last 6 or 7 years in terms of the work that the Woodrow Wilson Center that Howard Wolpe and I started in Burundi have been doing. He actually had the pleasure and the challenge of being one of the outside evaluators of our very first 2 years of work in Burundi, which was funded by the World Bank. So we've worked well with Peter. We've got some ongoing proposals that we're partnering on that we hope will further the kind of work that we've been doing as it focuses on youth and youth and violence. So it's really a delight to have Peter here. And secondarily, I'll introduce at the same time our respondent who's going to respond to Peter's presentation, Mark Summers, who likewise has been long involved and associated with the Africa program here at the Wilson Center. Mark is also actually based at Tufts at Fletcher, where he is Associate Professor of Humanitarian Studies and the Institute of Human Security at Fletcher, but is this year a fellow at the Jenny Randolph Senior Fellow at U.S. Institute of Peace. So we're very happy to have him a little closer to home so we can call on him more often. But Mark has been very involved, particularly in looking at youth and conflict. But again, all over Africa, we've worked with him in Burundi, in Rwanda, also in Liberia and Sierra Leone. So Mark is a very welcome addition to our panel this morning. So without further ado, let me turn it over to Peter.
Thanks, Steve.
Hello. Okay.
So good morning, all of you. I'm glad to be here. Thanks for coming. So I'm going to talk a little bit about a book I wrote, and it just came out, called Life After Violence, A People's Story of Burundi. I didn't make the title, but it's all right. So this is what it looks like. I forgot to bring any copies of it, so happily Mark had one on him. It's out with Zed Books, Z-E-D. In any case, you can just find it by going to Amazon.com for your Christmas shopping. So I'll give you 5 minutes of background to it, how it came about and what I try to achieve, and then we'll try to go into some of the content. At any time, feel free to ask me questions. Now, there's this strong light shining straight in my eyes, so I don't see very much. So you may have to jump up and down and make...
I'll kick him, don't worry.
But feel free at any time to ask me questions, okay? You don't necessarily
need
to...
We'll keep track of that for you, Peter.
Yes, yeah. So essentially what I did in this book is that I walked around in Burundi for about 9 months through both the countryside, about 6 months in the countryside, and about 3 months in the urban quartier populaire, which sometimes stupidly I translate by popular neighborhoods, but they're actually totally not popular. They are just very full of people, but basically the poor neighborhoods of the capital. And the goal of doing this was to pretty much listen to Burundians talk about life after war. And I wanted to do this, I wanted to hear Burundians speak as much as possible in their own voices and on their own terms. I mean to say, I have been for years, and I imagine many of you have as well, for years I've been associated with much of this post-conflict agenda, right? Where we try to promote combinations of development, security, good governance, human rights, respect, rule of law, and of course peace, and while we're at it, justice as well, and transitional justice, without forgetting obviously the environment, gender, and a few other quite important things. And I love that work. I have been a happy part of much of this. But I was very interested for a change in hearing Burundians talk about those same things, but without being prompted by me. That was the key to me. So I didn't want to ask questions about development, or about peace, or about governance, or about human rights. I wanted, however, to have Burundians analyze those things. So actually, Mark and I together even developed a sort of semi-anthropological method. It wasn't 100% anthropological, as in I didn't go and live for a couple of years in a particular place and fully let myself be embedded in local understandings. But it was certainly far away from your standard sort of survey or political science approach in which you try to organize, ask people about concepts that you have or questions that you have. It was a semi-anthropological method that was very open-ended and that deliberately asked a whole bunch of questions. Not that many, 15 or so, really, 15 to 20. Questions that were deliberately designed to have no answers to them. i.e. questions that you could not for the heck of you figure out what the right answer could be. So these questions were questions, the best ones, for example, were, who do you admire? There's no way that you can figure out what the right answer is to give to a Muzungu like me. So you have to somehow either not answer or start thinking for yourself outside of the box. Or questions like, if you were the local administrator here, what's the first thing you would do? So we had designed a number of questions like these that were carefully organized to be open-ended, not lead to any particular result, be even quite surprising at times, and frequently be also quite analytical in nature, that they would put people in the position of being analysts of their own society. Once again, I repeat, not once did we use the words governance, rights, peace, justice, any of these terms. Yet, obviously, people talked about those things. If they felt like it, and if they didn't feel like it, they didn't talk about it. And this was the interest of the methodology, really, to try to get a sense on people's own terms, how do they analyze the things that we work on too. And for me, the interest was then to combine this a bit, to step back then after having listened to hundreds of people and to sort of step back and say, does this, what emerges from, quote-unquote, below, does this match what we're working on? Does this match our documents, our policies, our understandings, our aims? Or do we live on different planets? I mean, we actually do live on different planets, but or do we at least, do we speak about the same things or do we not? That was, to me personally, the big question behind it all. One more thing is that, actually, again, quite influenced by Mark here, very much so even, I decided to focus on youth more than I had ever done in my life before. Mark is a specialist of youth. I am not. I actually had never worked in any particular way with youth before I did this. And as I spoke to him, I got to understand increasingly, that's true, when I go out there, when I talk to people, and I actually do frequently do that. I am proud of going outside of the city frequently, of going outside of the usual networks of those in power and the other specialists who talk my talk. I'm proud of that. But it's true. How many of them are below 40 or something, or below 30? The answer is, actually, come to think of it, almost nobody. And so yet youth is obviously the large numerical majority in a society like Burundi, but also it's very much associated with many of the things we think about when we think about violence and conflict and so on. And we tend to think of it, let's face it, in rather negative terms even, right? Especially young men, which was the main focus. So I sort of deliberately set out to interview about half of people below 30 and did so. So we did that. So we probably we didn't really oversample. I probably oversampled on young men, i.e. more men than there are in society. Probably about 60% of my conversations were with young men, and about 60% of my conversations were with men, sorry, out of which two-thirds were young men below 30, and about 40% were with women. One last word about that. So we chose, or I chose, three areas in the interior of the country. And those were chosen essentially because they represented three sorts of situations that people can live in a country coming out of war, including in Burundi. So one was an area, a town, a commune, as they call it there, that had been quite unaffected by the war. So while there had been, especially in 1993 and at a few other occasions, you know, some violence. There wasn't much. There were no major pogroms in that particular commune. Some folks had fled for a couple of nights, either to Rwanda, because it was neighboring Rwanda, or just into the in further away from their houses, but typically no more than a couple of days. And for the rest, mostly this place had been calm. And people were, by the way, quite proud of this. They were very proud that in their commune there had been no massive violence. A second commune was literally, you could see it from the first one, if you were on a high colline. It was maybe 5 miles away. It's called Ruhororo. The second commune was devastated by internal violence. 93 itself, many, many Tutsi were killed immediately in the initial violence after the president was killed. And after that, many of them fled, the Tutsi that is, to closer to the communal center where they would feel safer. This eventually became the basis for a gigantic IDP camp, a camp that at some point was Burundi's very biggest IDP camp. And when I was there in 2005-06, still had about 10,000 persons in it and was still at that time the biggest IDP camp in the country. So I spent about 6 weeks walking around in that camp and then about 3 more weeks walking around that camp. To talk to people. And then the third area was an area at the other side of the country, closer to Tanzania. That was the number one area of return of refugees. And so there was the other sort of situation. Folks who stayed at home in my first commune, folks who are IDPs in my second commune, and folks who returned from being refugees in my third one. Now, admittedly, in the third one, there are also many returned IDPs. This is a commune, actually. It's called Nyanza Lac. It's on the lake. And this is a commune that maybe had 10,000 inhabitants or something 5-6 years ago and now has 120,000. So it's a place of massive return. And so those were the three situations. And then finally, as said, I also spent about 2-3 months in Bujumbura, in the capital, because the capital is the capital. It's a totally different ballgame. And out there, mainly in two neighborhoods, a Hutu one called Kamenge, which was actually very much the heartland of much of the Hutu fight, and a Tutsi one. By the way, both of these were not mono-ethnic Hutu or Tutsi before the war became, before the war started. They became mono-ethnic as part of the war, and a Tutsi one. There was also a Quartier Populaire. And then at the end, to be frank, I also got 20, 30 interviews done with folks who did not live in either of these. I wanted to get some middle class. And so I just told my translators, go and interview your friends, people from college, whoever. So I got some bank managers and journalists and whatever as well, just to compare a bit. Voilà. That's pretty much the method. Any questions so far? Normally people have lots of questions about that.
Excuse me, I'm sorry. We are being webcast. I'd like you to wait for the microphone when you've been recognized as a question, and please give your name and et cetera so we get it recorded. Appreciate that.
Thank you. My name is Paul Francis. I work at the World Bank. The question is simply about, you mentioned interviewers. Can you say something about language and translation and many of these concepts that are being embedded in
people's languages? Should I say it again?
I heard the question.
Yeah, it's okay. I think we got that.
Thank you. If there is any more question, I can take them simultaneously or answer them all together.
We can do all at the end. We'll do.
Okay. So yeah. And by the way, I must say, now that I hear the words World Bank, the World Bank actually funded a good part of this research. So thanks. the rest came from a Guggenheim award that I received as well, but. Yeah, I use translators. I use two women who actually came out of a project that the Woodrow Wilson Center here was associated with, and who were women with university degrees who had lived for a couple of years in communes already as part of a conflict resolution local dialogue program. These were very well-trained people in elicitive listening methodologies. And they were quite unique because, you know, if you get a university degree, the last thing you want to do is go and live in a village again. The point of getting a university degree is precisely not to live there. So the fact that these people had been obliged to do that but had also acquired the tools and the experience to do that made them quite unique. Because translating isn't about the language. It's about the capacity to listen with respect and empathy, of listening carefully in a country like Burundi, where language is a complicated thing, and where a lot of what's said is said between the lines. So I had two young women I hired who had worked for 2 years in that project. I always worked with one of them and had the other one go on her own. So actually on all given days, there were two series of interviews going on, and I would just alternate between them. So I was myself part of about 50% of the interviews. And then in the evenings, we would sit down together and look at it. So they had the interviews in Kirundi, and then translated to me in French. And I wrote my notes in French. Admittedly, the book is in English. So it went through one more iteration of translation at the end. So that is true. Okay. Let me go into some of the subjects. So the book has chapters on all these big pieces of life: peace, governance, development, justice, and gender. So we could talk for the next 10 hours about this, which we won't. So I got to choose something to talk about. Let me give you precisely some of these responses to these questions that related to who do you admire. It leads, and by the way, the answers in the book aren't organized by question. It makes no sense. The questions are quite irrelevant. They're merely techniques to get somewhere. They're organized by topics. So while these questions, this particular question is very important here, it's by no means the only question that is informing what I'm going to say. But there are two strands that are really quite fascinating there. And also the other question precisely about what would you do if you were the local administrator here. So on that latter question, there is no doubt that the most frequent answers I received related to basic needs. Right? People talk to me about if they were in charge, they would make sure that there were jobs for everybody, or they would make sure that there were cows for everybody, or other sort of things that people consider truly, truly important for their survival. That's not surprising. We're talking about one of the five poorest countries in the world. And so that's as a group of answers, that's number one. But quite fascinatingly, number two, and if you actually add them up, it would even be potentially number one again, because there are so many answers like this, lies a whole different category of answers. And I divided it up into two. One is a category of answers that I used to code as respect. And it's answers like, if I were in charge here, or if I were the administrateur communal, I would treat all people the same, the big and the small. If I were the administrateur communal, I would listen to ordinary people as well. All kinds of answers like this that weren't for products as much as for processes, clearly, for ways of interacting with the state. And precisely, the who do you admire too, it frequently came there. I admire somebody, and then they would say some chef de colline, somebody whom they had encountered, some director of a school who treats everybody the same, some person who listens even to the poor. This was a very big strand of answers that came back throughout, and there was no particular separation between women and men, or old and young, or rural or urban. Throughout the country, this was a big strand that frequently came back. And then behind it was another strand which I coded as rule of law, which basically was systematically about corruption. Various things about, if I were the one here in charge, I would make sure that we are all having the same chances when we have an administrative conflict, or I would make sure that when there's aid coming, it's not only being given to the family of the administrator, or all these sort of questions, or I would make sure that you don't have to pay to get access to aid, all of sort of rule of law, anti-corruption kind of answers. And as I said, if you add those two together, they become single-handedly the number one category of answers I received. Which is really fascinating in a way. It sort of made me think, as I was walking around for those 9 months, in the back of my mind, that's fascinating. This is like folks are talking about human rights, about citizenship. They're not using any of these terms. Almost nobody used the words human rights ever. The only people who did were a few of the highly educated people in the city who used the word human rights, and actually, interestingly enough, a bunch of ex-combatants, typically those who are not in the party in power or were not part of the military movement associated with the party in power. So the term human rights is used very rarely. It came up almost never spontaneously in any conversations. And I said only two small groups of people brought it up. Nonetheless, I thought, when people are talking about these things like being treated equitably, being treated with respect, having the rules applied to all, aren't they talking about basically non-discrimination, about dignity? And aren't those the very basic concepts that underlie human rights? And couldn't I henceforth not make an argument that Burundians in their own way talk about those things, and that when outsiders such as us push for those things, that we actually are connected to Burundians? And I still believe this to be in part correct. Yet, when I came home, and I started looking more carefully, actually rereading my notes, which I wasn't doing in the field that much. I had no time to reread them. I barely had time to enter them in the computer at night. But when I started carefully rereading them, I was pushed to actually reconsider, at least in part, my interpretation of what I had been hearing. It seemed increasingly to me that Burundians were actually very much using the same words and the same terms, and they were referring to Bashingantai, in a way. Now, a little step back. Those of you who are Burundian or who have lived in Burundi know what this means right away. It's a sort of traditional institution that used to exist certainly before colonization, and to some extent may or may not exist until today, in which wise men, and there are always men, who were chosen by the community on the basis of their demonstrated, longly proved integrity. They cared about the public good. They were objective. They listened carefully. They could make judgments locally and try to solve or at least recommend solutions to people that would be fair, based on a full understanding of the facts, carefully arrived at, and so on. Those people are called Bashingantai, and it's also called the institution of Bashingantai. And it seemed to me that people were actually talking about that the whole time. They were using the same words that we associate with Bashingantai. And in many other parts in the conversation, this came back as well. One of my translators asked a whole bunch of people, what is it to be a man? He added this question on his own, which was kind of fun. What does it mean to be a man? And it's amazing how much those very same things came back. A man is somebody who listens objectively to all, who cares for the common good. It's that image that comes back over and over again. And so, as a conclusion of this little section, my feeling is that what I really heard then is, yes, some of the same things that outsiders frequently talk about when they talk about citizenship or human rights and so on. Issues of non-discrimination, issues of dignity, issues of equality before the law, or at least in treatment. But when we think about this, when we as outside agencies, AID or IFS or whatever, when we think about this, we think of structures, right? We think of how to create structures that will allow these things to be materialized within a society. The right sort of laws, the courts that can uphold those laws, separation of power and media that can expose abuses of laws, and so on. Burundians, it seems to me, were not talking about structures. They were talking about people. We think spontaneously when we think about these things of better structures. They think, I think, spontaneously of better people. And they have in mind a kind of people that is still, if not necessarily physically alive, because I do not think that there are that many Bashingantai left who truly have that traditional statute, although some may. But the institution, the sense of norms, the sense of personal behavior associated with that is still very much alive. And it is still something by which people judge both the reality out there, and they judge it frequently, mostly negatively, and they even judge themselves, or at least they aspire to that. So it's a fascinating way to see the similarity and the difference between us when we talk about those things. This is one little part.
Okay. Why don't we let Mark make a little response? He's read the book, and then we'll get back to questions.
Read the book.
Try to.
I don't know how many drafts of this thing I've read.
You didn't have to read that.
How many drafts, Peter?
Enough.
Anyway, I wanted to start off with just reading a passage, and then I have some comments. And Peter writes at the end of, I think, the introduction. How do ordinary Burundians in the hills and the ghettos look at life? What does peace mean to them? How do they relate to the state? How do they see socioeconomic progress taking place in their own lives? What are their priorities? And what are the gender aspects of all this? It is to their insights into these matters that the rest of this book is devoted. We first need a short chapter on methodology. Please stick with it. It is not as bad as you might fear, and really helpful to an understanding of the rest of the book. Now, it seems to me that what you get from this paragraph is a kind of a disarming informality, accessibility, and I think much of the book is really quite charming because Peter's clearly so interested in what ordinary Burundians have to say. There is that sort of just their basic view or the elemental kinds of aspects of their lives. There's such interest in this. And then there's a suggestion that considering methods is useful and interesting. And of course, he talked, gave some detail about that. Now, since we were asked originally to do this work together on youth in Central Africa, with an emphasis on masculinity, by the World Bank, I wanted to talk a little bit about the differences between what we found from devising the same methodology, that is, the same sampling in both countries, for youth in both countries. Then these were done separately, but the methods were developed before we started the work. We worked it out together with someone else, a former student of Peter's, Kim Howe, as well. And what we're basically doing, what we sort of worked out was to find out what people think in policy terms, to find out what people think, what youth think in both countries, and then to devise policy responses to that. Now, for Central Africa, this is absolutely radical. You don't ask, you know, poor, uneducated people what they think about anything, really. Because why? They don't have any education. It's the role of the educated to inform. There's a phrase that's used in both countries by the elites. We inform the population, okay? And that informing the population is the role of elites. And leading them, telling them about development is the role of elites. These people need education. And with education, then they can develop themselves, things like that. So this is a radical approach, not just for Central Africa, but most certainly for a place as hierarchical as Central Africa traditionally always has been. So in asking these same questions, we came up with some really different responses. And I thought that I would just share a little bit about that to give you a dramatic contrast, because it really was strikingly different in the two countries in fundamental ways. And then I wanted to turn to three points that I think are particularly interesting from Peter's book. So I just wrote down a couple of the questions that Peter mentioned just now. Who do you admire? That was a really interesting question for Peter and his colleagues in Burundi. It didn't work in Rwanda. It felt people I know were, I think what they were thinking, we dropped the question. And I think the reason is that people thought that that question was political. And so it colored the conversation. Like, I think they were expecting us to say, who do you admire, like Paul Kagame? And so it was a question that just didn't work. Another one was, if you were the local administrator, what's the first thing you would do? A lot of poor youth in Rwanda took that question and could not answer it, particularly many female youth. Why was that? Well, I think that there is, to answer a question like that, you have to have a quality of imagination. You have to be able to see yourself as a person in that position, the mayor or the head administrator for the area. Now, Burundian youth, no matter how poor, were generally able to do that. In Rwanda, some could, many could not. And one thing that was sort of a broader perspective in Rwanda is comparing the two, and this is really a striking issue, I think, it seems to me, that we get from this research, and something that I think is really uplifting about this book about looking at a country like Burundi, is that Burundian youth there's an accent in their work, which Peter is suggesting in his presentation, that in their view that they can move up in society. They're very upbeat, and I'll mention this issue of the capitalist ethos that they have shortly. What about in Rwanda? It almost did not exist. In Rwanda, people were unbelievably risk-averse. So the whole idea was not about accent, was not about moving up in society. It was trying to stabilize your situation so you didn't fall any further down. And that theme came up over and over and over again in Rwanda. Stunningly so. Now, these are two countries where the popular sort of impression is that Burundi is a mess, and Rwanda is about, if I looked at the country assistance strategy in Rwanda, for Rwanda from the World Bank, the aim is to become a middle-income country. A dramatic difference had to do with this question of a very simple question, and these are deceptively simple questions, and I think Peter touched on this really well, because they have a deep resonance and there is no answer. Now, this is important for people who go and have rote learning education systems. So devising questions that are really, truly open-ended signifies that you're interested in who they are. So one of them was, do you have a plan for improving your situation? Now, virtually every person, I remember Peter sending over a very brief section on education early on. Virtually every Burundian youth responded with education. Almost no Rwandan youth mentioned education in their answers. In an area where the level of expansion of education in the country is unprecedented in Rwandan history. What do we learn from this? Well, Peter, I think, sums it up, and I'm just going to quote, education means that you are not stuck anymore in the prison that rural life represents for many people. What about in Rwanda? Well, Rwanda, education was a value for youth, but it wasn't a priority. You had to drop out of school to start working to build a house for young men, so that you could set the stage for possibly, hopefully, getting married. For young women, after the genocide, there's a lot more women than men in that country. If you don't drop out and start saving some money, who's going to marry you? So it's a very different dynamic there. Again, being risk-averse as opposed to having a sense of aiming high and going someplace. So the power of the book, I think, lies in Peter's book, in how it reveals core ideas, perceptions, and priorities of these non-elite majority young people in the country. And the utility is that over and over again, Peter returns to how ordinary Burundians and the international humanitarian and development apparatus, structure, agencies address the same things, usually in very different ways, as he pointed out about issues such as human rights. Three final points. The capitalist ethos is a very interesting idea, finding. I think it's quite significant that Burundian youth, female as well as male, have this idea that, you know, they can sort of with an entrepreneurial idea, you know, make it, or, you know, if they don't work hard, they're not going to make it, and that's their problem. Okay. Another is this issue of these regular reflections on differences between what Burundian citizens and international aid experts see as priorities. And one he mentions has to do with the international community in these humanitarian post-war situations overlook urban youth almost completely, which is quite significant. And finally, on gender, there's a lot of inspiring information about Burundian youth sort of pushing the edges of traditional roles on female youth, on marriage, and, you know, entering into being entrepreneurs and doing new things. That's really happening in Burundi far more than in Rwanda, far more than in Rwanda. And finally, I just wanted, this is just an interesting quote at the end on how you become an adult. Peter says, Burundi seems more able to adapt to young men's inability to achieve normative manhood than other societies, most certainly much more than Rwanda. And I think what this says is that we have this creative, adaptive society in Burundi, which gives us a lot of a very hopeful possibilities for its future and for figuring out how to support these really extraordinary young people in that country. And I think the bigger idea is that we have an awful lot to learn from Burundi. And I certainly didn't realize that Peter and I have been working on Rwanda and Burundi for, I don't know, 20 years or more? More for you, I think. 20 for me. It was really surprising and inspiring to find out how much we could learn from these young people in Burundi. So I'll end there and hand it over to Steve. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mark. We're going to open up for questions now. Just a quick comment of my own, because I'm fascinated at the themes that Peter has picked up and Mark has commented on in his book in terms of how much they reflect the thesis that Howard Wolpe and I went into our work in Burundi in 2002 with. And that is, if you will, to be simplistic about it, the people-centric approach. We too felt through our years of doing peace processes in Burundi in the Arusha process, but going all the way back to the Anglo-American Accords and Lancaster House with Rhodesia, Zimbabwe for myself, and the Namibian negotiations and Howard's work in Sun City, and we found that this tendency to focus on institution building, on the process of democracy as we Westerners understand it, beginning with elections, always left out the people part. And that if you weren't working with reconciliation, trust building, communications, and et cetera, with the top leadership, that nothing was going to be sustained. And maybe I'm just looking for something, but I find a great deal of a confirmation of that view of Howard's and mine in what your book says. I could ask many more questions myself, but you know the process. Please raise your hand. We'll go with two or three questions at a time, I think. And let either Peter and or Mark field them. Wait for the microphone when it comes around and introduce yourself. First one.
Hello. Good morning. I'm Robert Daguiar from the Voice of America here in Washington. Professor Yuvin, as Professor Summers explained, these are very hierarchical societies, Rwanda and Burundi. To what extent did you have to prompt people or encourage ordinary people to participate in your survey? Or did you get any people telling you or giving you the impression that perhaps it was not their place to answer questions about, you know, their future, the future of the country, institution, that sort of things? And second, perhaps you would care to read some of the most representative answers that were given to your survey, if you happen to have the text in front of you.
Okay, see a question here. Come, come. It's okay, you can do on-camera time, Sonia.
Do I have to do something?
No.
Okay. I'm Herbert Weiss, and my local association is with Woodrow Wilson Center. first, let me say I really find this most fascinating, and I'm glad I came here rather than the Great Lakes Policy Forum. my first question, and for the time being, I only have two, but I hope I can get back, is you don't mention Tutsi Hutu. Mm-hmm. Now, were you able to identify your interlocutors? Were you allowed to identify them in terms of Tutsi Hutu in Rwanda? And if you were able, either intuitively or through direct question, able to identify them, statistics is not an issue here, but what is, okay, how does that divide work? And then jumping way beyond the limits of your study, something that I've been very concerned with, and although it's not an area that I work in or have any expertise in, is what are the dangers of the very different paths that Rwanda and Burundi have taken for each other. In other words, is the example of Burundi undermining Rwanda? Is the example of Rwanda undermining Burundi's future ability to achieve progress, stability, etc.?
Okay, very good. We could take one more if we... These are right, yeah, right at the back there. We could have stopped there too, that's a lot.
Hello, my name's Rachel Kerr. I'm a fellow here at the Wilson Centre. And I'm really glad I came here this morning as well, because this has been absolutely fascinating. My sort of area of interest is transitional post-conflict justice. And I'm working here on Western Balkans, but also interested obviously in Africa, because there's many, many initiatives going on. And one of the things that's often struck me about work on justice, on transitional justice, when people have taken the time to go and ask the local population what they think about it, is that if you ask people what's important, they don't mention justice. But if you ask them if they think justice is important, then they do. They say, yes, of course it is. So, because what I'm interested in is in your kind of approach, which seems to me to be really quite radical and really very potentially very useful, is what kinds of responses did you elicit around justice, and how did you get there? What kinds of questions did you ask to get those responses, and sort of what came out of it? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
This should be good enough to keep me busy for 2 minutes. the hierarchical society's issue is quite interesting. Generally, no prompting was necessary. No. People spoke actually with great ease, including women. There was not the slightest issue. All it took was to take your time to be on their terms, hang out in front of the hospital if women were waiting with their kids to go in, or besides a field or at their porch as they were waiting or working or whatever. It was not hard. I did a few group interviews, and in that case, young girls spoke far less than anybody else. But if you took a young girl alone, she would speak again with great ease. I think the ones whom I found it by far and away hardest to speak with were the poorest. We had a way of monitoring and of putting people into categories of income, because this was quite important as well. Basically, in each case, about three or four levels, and they were based on local markers of income. And so at the very end, when the interview was basically entirely over, I would sort of say, oh, by the way, I just would like you to ask two, three stupid little questions for me. If they hadn't already by accident told me spontaneously during the conversation, and that related to how many animals they had and what kind of animals in the rural area, whether they hired people to work on their land, whether there was somebody in the family, in the household, who had an income, and so on. And it allowed me to rapidly put people into sort of categories. And it was always clear as we reached the end of a week and we would sort of look, okay, who have we seen this week? That we had frequently the very lowest, the category called destitute, was the one we had least of. In part because they're not that visible. They're not easily around you. They don't show themselves. And indeed, because when you do find people, because after some time you figure out where they live, and they live further away from roads, obviously, almost always, they are not so interested in speaking to you. I think in part because they're ashamed of their situation. Others, for example, will easily invite you to come into their house and sit. They feel ashamed of their place because there is nothing. There's not even anything to sit on, maybe. And so those were the hardest. So if prompting was necessary, it was actually mainly with the very poorest, nobody else. On the other hand, there were people who came up to us and said, hey, why don't you talk to me? You've been here already for a week and you never came to my place. And so people, and by the way, all the women were very good at that frequently. So no, not a big issue.
Can I just mention, I'm sure this happened in Burundi too. You know, in these valleys, people communicate by just shouting and it goes down. And so
where's the white man? He's coming down to your house. Oh, I wanted to be interviewed too. Well, he's...
Anyway, I'm sure that happened in Burundi too. There's this,
he's coming down.
After some time, everybody knew I was around.
See him coming down the hill.
Yes. I won't give representative answers. There are way too many. And the problem with the book is it deals with so many different issues. For example, everything Mark discussed already about attitudes towards work and capitalism and towards education, I haven't even had the time to talk about it. There's so much more in the book. It goes all over. The Tutsi-Hutu question, I did not ask personally the question. I, however, very frequently do know, in part because sometimes there are geographic concentrations of people, like the IDP camp in Ruhororo is an exclusively Tutsi camp. So you can know. Same with Kamenge, it's pretty much almost exclusively Hutu there. And so sometimes you know because of concentrations, and frequently you know when people tell you about the story of their lives. And one of the first questions I usually ask to somebody was something about, you know, have you always been here or have you been moving around in the last years? And of course, very frequently folks had moved all over, right? Spent, fled to there, then gone there, then this and that. And in that story, you can very frequently figure out whether they're Hutu Tutsi within about 1 minute, right? So I knew very frequently, but I didn't ask. There were very few differences in answers that I'm aware of between Hutu and Tutsi. It was not a driver of many things. The biggest single area where there was a noticeable difference was around the issue of justice, as a matter of fact. And this brings me right away to your question. What you observe is 100% correct. So in my methodology, which does not ask a single question about justice, but allows people to talk about what's important to them, justice almost never comes up. Mm-hmm. Yes, people do not spontaneously bring it up. Mm-hmm. Even though I spend frequently hours and hours, 2, 3, 4 hours with people, justice does not come up. I had at the time also for about 2 months a student of mine who was doing research on justice. And so I took her to the same communes just, you know, so she could use my car and hang out with me and benefit from my contacts and so on. So interestingly enough, I have her answers on justice in the very same places as where I was, sometimes some of the same people even. And so she and I ended up writing an article together about our joint results about justice. She only did about the 10th the interviews I did. She did about 50, I think. I did 400. But the thing is, she has 50 answers about justice, whereas I maybe have 35 out of 400 who talked about it. But together, nonetheless, we have like 90. So we combined, we pooled our results. And it is true, once you ask and you oblige people to have an answer, then obviously they do have answers. And in that respect, some of the answers run very differently. Very, very, very briefly, most Burundians, in my sense, and precisely, prefer silence. So their answers to most justice mechanisms being proposed is that they do not want them. They do not prefer them. They prefer silence. Mm-hmm. They prefer silence over courts. They prefer silence even over truth commissions most of the time. And that came out very much in my interviews because I didn't force people to talk about it. So when they did talk about it, very much that's what they said. Let's turn this page. Talking about it makes us no better off. There was a small group that did want justice, and very punitive justice. They wanted perpetrators to be brought to justice right here, right now, and if necessary, for that matter, killed or penalized and whatever. And that was far stronger amongst people in IDP camp, for example, than anywhere else, i.e. amongst Tutsi in this case, where there's a strong sense that a genocide was committed against them and that something should be done about it. The guilty should be punished. This was not all of them remotely either, but it was stronger. And it was also a bit stronger in the city amongst more educated people. So I think that this says something about that when people are more politicized for whatever reason, either because they are in the business of being more politicized, as quite many middle-class people are in the city, because you can't survive easily if you're not quite politicized, or because you're stuck in a situation where maybe, you know, in these camps, you're in a situation that's not normal, where you're maybe much more under control of politicians as well, or where in normal life doesn't take place. So the degree of politicization increases, and the degree of radicalization concomitantly increases too, with much more strong judgments about people got to be punished out here. So I don't think it's as much an ethnic thing, like those Tutsi have it in. Not at all. It's, I think, a thing of politicization. But most people where they live prefer by far a strategy that's based on maintaining, on turning the page, on rebuilding some relations, on having some social capital function, on making networks work again, rather, and they fear formal justice in that respect. There's way more to say about this, way more, but that's it for now.
Did I answer Herb's question?
Yeah, the question on the implications for Rwanda, Burundi, future dangers of those impacting on each other.
Can I do that, or do you want to do that, Peter?
I didn't ask those questions to people, so I have nothing. You will only hear my personal opinion, and that's it. I want to talk about what Burundians told me.
Yeah. So I'll go very quick so we can get back to Burundi. The ethnicity issue is in mention of the Hutu Tutsi in Rwanda. That would be a recipe for not being able to do research in Rwanda. And we found it to be absolutely irrelevant. I wouldn't have learned anything new if I had to ask about ethnicity. I think one of the things, and I think Prunier put this in his book on the Rwandan genocide years ago, that the West has an obsession with ethnicity, and that they see ethnicity in a way that's exaggerated. And the thing that they overlook in a place like Rwanda is class. And that was a much more resonant issue by far. The people on up, the people with development, the people without development, the people up there at the top of the hill, the rest of us down here and so forth. That was the really resonant idea. And ethnicity was easy to interpret anyway on that. So it really wasn't a relevant or useful question. About the dangers of the different paths, I don't know. I mean, the Rwandan government didn't want this to talk about this being a regional study. They really wanted this to be a standalone study. The idea of having a study that was done in concert with Burundi was something that they weren't particularly interested in. So what's going on at the level below that, I think, would depend on... I don't know. I didn't see much in the way that they would interact. These countries seem to be moving away from each other in significant ways.
If I may, because Peter won't, in my associations, it's only about since 1993 that I've been in and out of Burundi, but I do find that there is a very troubling progression of developments in Burundi, in Rwanda as compared to Burundi in terms of ethnic issues. I think this sort of no ethnicity denial of any exploring of ethnicity in Rwanda, where everybody is so conscious of it, and it's such a basis of tension underneath this calm surface that we see, is a recipe for some trouble down the line. And I think by putting everything on the table in Burundi in these last years, that it's become a non-issue. There is, of course, the Western approach to ethnicity is always very simplistic. I did learn in these last years, and I've not done the kind of research that Peter and Mark have done, but over the years I've interacted with on a fairly intimate and intense basis with hundreds and hundreds of Burundians, and I've found that the problem always in Burundian minds, if there, you know, when the war was underway, when things were, it was the Bururi Tutsi who were the bad guys. Tutsi outside of the Bururi area felt as violated put upon as Hutu did in terms of being left out of the power structure and left out of any say in the national. So we don't always understand. And of course, then there's the third group as well, Twa, who are left out by everybody and then put upon. So ethnicity is an interesting.
May I actually add? I want to add two more small, very empirical points, but they complement and very richly add, I think, to this. One last thing. People did like very much the idea of talking about the past in a way as to sharing the joint suffering. That was something people did not mind at all. They just did not want to get into the business, I think, of attributing guilt and separating out the guilty from the others. Mm. And there may be various reasons for that, including the fact that they may think that guilt might be more widespread. But one of the reasons that I think is very important is the following. Remember this question, who do you admire? An enormous number of answers would say something. Because, by the way, I got few names on this question. I thought I would get names, like Zidane or something, or the Pope, or, you know, and then I would sort of figure out the underlying criteria. I did get very few names. I most of the time got criteria. I admire somebody who has the following features. And frequently I would ask, by the way, and do you know somebody like this? And the answer would be no. but sometimes I did. Sometimes I did mention particular people as well. But whether it was a theoretical profile of an admirable person or an empirical profile of somebody who has done something admirable, a very, very big one was they would describe something where somebody stood up for somebody, typically. Right? In the camp, there was this cell block leader who stood up when somebody was unjustly accused of stealing things, and he knew it wasn't true. But then it would always end up with the following lines, comma, even though he was from the other ethnic group. It would almost always end up like this. So the admirability, or the thing to be admired, was the non-ethnicness of the response, I think. I take this also with answer to other questions about how entente is, how the living is in where they live, where people overwhelmingly and exclusively told me that there are no problems here. We are all living the same issues and so on. So Burundians very much presented themselves to me as people who either have moved beyond ethnicity or who desire to move beyond ethnicity. That's why they respect it so much. Notice, pay attention, the fact that it's so rare means that you respect it. If it were everybody doing it, then there wouldn't be no particular reason to respect it, right? Like, I admire somebody who breathes through his nostrils. Nah, right? We all do. So there's a dual thing there. It's not necessarily that prevalent. That's why you talk about it with great admiration. Yet at the same time, the fact that you admire it so much shows how you aspire to it. Yeah? And I think that Burundians very much, ordinary people throughout the country, in their own minds, either have already turned or wish to turn that page. And there's a very powerful change there. I think that they gave war a chance, so to speak, and they figured pretty much out it ain't working. And there's a very powerful change there. And that too relates back to the justice question, in that's coming back to the past. It's digging up painful stuff again, which, let's stay away from it. I just wanted to add this.
Okay, more questions. Here's one in front here, and the second one there, and a third one here, and then we'll have answers.
Well, thank you. I'm Edward Bizimana from Burundi. I would like to make some comments, just small comments about some of the questions. The first one of talking of Hutu Tutsi, that's not a problem in Burundi now. Because we learned from the past that people try to hide it. But being a Hutu, being a Tutsi, that's not the problem. The problem was the way it was politically exploited and the consequences. So now we decided to talk about it, to see what is bad about it, what is good. And I think we are moving forward. So the other question, the issue I would like to raise is the question of Ubushingantahe. Institution. So this is something which was very important to Burundians. And this goes with another aspect which we call Ubuntu. Ubuntu, this is a core value which makes a human being a human being. There are qualities that make you a Mushingantahe, and this Ubuntu is part of it. So what we, especially youth, see, they say that there was a crisis of this Ubushingantahe, this institution, because of the lack of the other value, Ubuntu. So that is why youth are trying to get involved to make things move forward. And the other question was about the question, who do you admire? So this probably had to go with the other question, whom do you know? because sometimes they are limited to Burundi or their region because probably of the lack of broad knowledge about what is around them, Africa, Europe, I mean, the whole world. So this was very important, I think, because as we were trying to discuss the future of our country as young people, we had problems of model. Because when we looked at our history, recent history, we couldn't figure out why we had to go so far in all the problems we went through. So where were these people called Abashingantahe? So people are now trying to figure out how to set up their models, their own models, how they can be better people. Thank you.
Thank you. The young lady across there, yeah.
Gabrielle Bartle with IFES this morning. Well, coming from IFES, I have questions that relate to elections and to the institutional side of things that your study, in an excellent way, worked outside of. Really appreciate it. I'm wondering, these interviews were taken immediately following the elections in 2005, and the context in Burundi was in full swing of change in terms of institutional developments, elections, decentralization, and all of this. I was wondering if those changes were reflected and how in the responses that you did receive, and what the implications of the institutional development might have been, in your opinion, on these responses, and vice versa, how the elements that you found through this study may be influencing the developing institutions within the country, both traditional institutions as the Bashingantahe and the new, more formal ones that have emerged since the transition. Thanks.
And then Sonia, saw a hand over here? Yeah, right over here.
Thanks. Brian Stout, desk officer with USAID for Burundi. I was interested in the comment about the imaginative quality that Professor Summers referred to, but I wanted to turn it back to the Burundian context. And I appreciate the radical nature from an academic perspective of actually trying to get the perspectives of ordinary Burundians. But my question is, the questions themselves or the way they spoke, was that in itself novel or new to them? Did you have a sense that that type of political space or apolitical space, I guess, mm-hmm. for dialogue existed when they come back from the farms or what have you? Did those conversations take place, or do you think that was really the first time someone had asked him to think, if I were president or if I were, you know, commune leader? Thanks.
Okay, shall we tackle those?
Okay, so as to our Burundian colleague, I actually agree entirely with every single point you made. So thank you. As to Gabriela's question, the elections, yes, you're right. My work took place in the context of the immediate post-transition, both from war to peace and presumably from a more authoritarian or at least unclear system to a democratic one, in theory at least. Certainly elections had taken place and they were successful and peaceful and so on. The decentralization thing is far less important. Burundi has been, in theory, decentralizing for the last 25 years already. That's nothing that new. It's just new to all of us, as we always sort of being fed the same lines, and we have no idea of history, but it's been going on since very long. But how does this influence, indeed, either their answers or their relations? It's hard to say. Well, one of the things is that the president at the time was certainly a very popular man. For example, on the who do you admire question, the few times a name did come up, our friend Nkurunziza won big time. He got my popularity medal big time. But more broadly, he was popular mainly not so much for having won the elections, obviously, but for the peace. People attributed to him the leadership that brought the peace about, and number two, for the primary education, which was deeply appreciated the idea of it, although the practice was slightly lagging behind, nonetheless, there was a big issue as well. As Mark already said, given that for Burundians, education is absolutely at the very heart for young Burundians of their strategies for change in life, even though very few will ever make it, all of them do try it, that was very, very, very big. I have the impression that the capacity for people to elect folks they respected at the local level was not nothing. But I think, although I didn't ask specific questions about it, that's the limitation of my methodology. If they don't tell me, as I don't ask, I don't know. But I think that the level that actually met, that where they felt proud of having been able to elect people they trusted, was far lower than the commune. It was actually the cells and so on, the collines. At that level, where many of them spontaneously pointed out that, you know what, we got this woman, and she is now our conseiller, eh? And so on. The problem here is that they actually basically have squat, zilch power. They mean nothing in the system. In theory, they mean something, but they mean nothing. None of us works with them. USAID wouldn't, IFS doesn't, there are too many, the World Bank with Pradex doesn't. Nobody does, because in part because there are too many of them, and it's just, you know, there are thousands upon thousands, so we tend to stop at the commune. We don't connect to them. Nothing that we do connects to that. So I think that that potential has not materialized that much. Are these questions new, Brian asks? They're certainly new that a guy like me would ask them. That is for sure. People found it very funny and totally weird, far out weird. And because especially if you live close to a center of something or to a road and there is a major project around, the chance that you have been surveyed at some point is reasonable, eh? Because surveys happen a lot. But they're very traditional. There are all these prefixed questions, 75 of them, and they run through them, and hups, bye-bye. But this sort of hours-lasting, open-ended conversation is certainly very, very unique. But you ask a different question, which is, do people themselves, between themselves, talk about this? Not do they talk about it, but outsiders pay to ask them questions. Mm-hmm. I presume they do. A priori, I don't know either way. But I do think that they do. Very frequently when I had these conversations, people would come in and join the conversations. You would start with one person, and before you know it, after an hour, there are four, five, six others sitting around, right? Either family members have come in, or neighbors, or other women come and hang out with the first woman. And clearly many of these things started leading to animated discussions between all of them, and there seemed to be nothing that stopped people from engaging in this with great abandon and joy. This is where Burundi clearly, in general, is just a great place where conversations take place freely and lots of laughter, even about very painful things. Burundians often hide painful things behind laughter. But nonetheless, yeah, people do talk. Oh, yeah.
Mark, do you have any addition on those questions?
Well, just the one about the questions is I had a lot of very happy conversations with Rwandans youth that they were just sort of stunned by the questions. I mean, very similar. And I think the thing about these questions is that they really register early on that this big strange foreign guy, you know, for actually both of us, is so interested in us. And so one of the things that really worked in the methodology in both countries is that we would go back and back and back to the same neighborhood, the same area. Mm-hmm. And that's just unheard of. I mean, there was one place where they got really worried about me going down the hill. And they said, "Are you really going down to the hills? It's my first day in this area." I said, "Yeah, why?" They said, and somebody from the government came down and said, "You know, you need to come back and talk to us." Well, what were they so worried about? Well, the last guy who ever went down that hill, a white man, was before the genocide. It was apparently a big, fat German guy, and he went down the hill and he couldn't get back up. And they had to put him on a stretcher and carry him up. It was a really steep hill. And so they were really worried. Like, you know, if he gets down, oh, no, well, at least it isn't too heavy. You know, we could probably carry him up with a few men. I don't know. And but it was just a way of describing that just being there and going back every day, I think, for Peter's work as well, was really unusual. And I think that that really created... helped to create environments where people, you know, as Peter said, you know, talked for a long time and not with specific questions, mm-hmm. but very openly. There's not a lot of qualitative research going on in Rwanda. I don't think there has been one as extensive as mine since 94. And I did not get the impression, Peter, that there has been much qualitative research in Burundi, but I don't know that.
No, there hasn't. No.
Let me chime in. I can't help but doing it from time to time, because on that, what Mark's comments remind me of the importance. Again, we weren't involved in any kind of research of this nature in that kind of depth, obviously doing a very, very different kind of work there. But if there has been a level of success by the Woodrow Wilson Center project with the Burundi Leader Training Program in Burundi, it has been because of its sustainability. We've had the luxury of some USAID support, World Bank support, and others that's kept us going there now for 7 years. And I mention that because Burundians don't believe you're going to stay around. That's Mark's point. When we first came in to interview, there was a great deal of respect for my colleague Howard Wolpe because of the role he played as special envoy, respect for me because I'd been there in years past for 10 years or so. But no one believed we were actually going to be there a year from there or 2 years from then. And because we have been, and because when we come back over and over again, we are in people's homes, we come out for dinner, they invite us to weddings, they invite us to funerals, we have an interaction that is very unique, we get the same kind of response. It's just, you know, my goodness, just the fact that you care enough to come over and over again. So it's a very, very important part of any kind of project. If the people of Burundi or any other country are the ones you're reaching out to. Let's go for, we have time for another round of questions. Have we run out of questions? I didn't think so.
Just took a little prompting.
If it's toward the end, I guess I have to ask this question. I'm Eric Nelson. I'm a retired World Bank economist. Steve recalls from when I was mugged in Bujumbura and we had to rent some of my glasses. The title of the book, which you didn't choose yourself, you said, is Life After Violence. And until the questions got into the question of justice and people not, except for a bit of retribution or not, and trying to put the past aside, there's nothing in here so far for us practitioners who are used to thinking the way that you opened your talk in terms of the various classifications. Can you tell us, is there anything that you learned from this research that would help to prevent a second Burundi or to help countries that are in a post-conflict situation to recover?
I think right beside you, Eric, yeah.
Actually, my question follows on precisely from that one, which is, you've drawn a contrast, I think, in between a sort of structural institutional approach, whose shortcomings are now fairly obvious, and a more populist one, if I may say so. But that populist one seems to be based around, if I understand correctly, and I've heard it elsewhere, for example, in Nigeria, with the Chinua Achebe's critique of leadership, around individual moral qualities. And my sense is that that may be something of a dead end as well in terms of policy speak. So I'm wondering, is there some middle way between the structural and the kinds of, I think, fundamentally moral insights which you're getting from what you hear? Thanks.
And you are, I'm sorry?
Paul Francis, World Bank.
Thank you. And one last one, Sonia, right at the back to your left. Had to wait for you to turn.
I'm Nancy Welch. I work at the National Endowment for Democracy. And we have a few grants in Burundi and I think two in Rwanda right now. I'm curious to know if you had any impressions about people's sort of sense of activism, if they had any interest in activism in both Burundi and Rwanda, or if, you know, they weren't interested. Thanks.
Okay, that should take us out nicely.
Oh, those are big ones that actually would need more reflection time than I have. Yes, about the question of did I learn things that would help practitioners to think through how to prevent further violence or renewed violence in Burundi. Oh yeah, I think that there is a lot there, as a matter of fact. But it would take us, we would have to go far deeper in first hearing what Burundians had to say and then thinking through the implications for our agenda. At the biggest level, I would say our agenda, so to speak, our sort of general post-conflict agenda with its various pillars and the things we believe in, largely matches what Burundians talk about, actually, which is kind of interesting. It does. The biggest difference, I would say, is that what we talk about as the importance we attach to democracy and justice is far lower to Burundians. But I think that some of the things that result from it in terms of good governance that we think will follow from these things, Burundians care very much about those. So at the broadest terms, we are talking about the same things as Burundians. They care about what we care about, and we're not besides the point. A second thing is that, however, we far underestimate the degrees of change and the opportunities that have taken place in a country like this. Both, for example, in terms of popular understandings and demands for non-discrimination and a new way of interacting with local government and the real potential that existed for that, which I think has not been used at all, in part because of our attachment to just macro democracy. I think we misunderstood it. We're looking in the same direction, but we are seeing different things. Another one is this, what I consider major willingness of Burundians to move beyond ethnicity and to truly turn that page. I think most people don't realize how deep that is, that change, and how one could have built maybe on that differently. That's easier said than done, just sitting here and saying it in vague terms. The question is, of course, concretely, what are we going to do? Concretely, what we're going to do would certainly not be determinable sitting here today. It would be something that would require listening and acting more carefully. I think, though, what it certainly tells us is that methods such as these to listen carefully can yield fascinating and important results relatively rapidly. I mean, it's not that fast, frankly. It takes a year, which is not nothing. On the other hand, let's face it, almost everything we do takes far longer than we say it's going to take. Mm-hmm. Right? So we can as well sort of face up to this right away and do things well up front. So number one of my recommendations would be do stuff like this in any post-conflict country right away from the very first day you can, which is typically relatively fast, and try to think through what it means with local partners in government and civil society and so on. You may discover opportunities you never thought existed. And as the point would be to build on what exists within society rather than to import what we think is useful, that might be a very powerful way to adapt at the very least, if not redesign entirely what we do. Yeah, this question about these individual moral qualities, is it a dead end? I actually had this discussion frequently as well with Howard and Steve years ago around their own project, because their project is very much based, as Steve already outlined earlier, on this presumption that it's individuals that matter. Now, I myself, coming from a development background and a political science background, I'm spontaneously always inclined to think, no, it's institutions that matter. Because individuals, after all, you know, they change, they can be killed, they move around, and in any case, what they do is so much driven by the incentive structures created by institutions. It's institutions that matter, right? And they always say, no, Peter, no institution functions or is given meaning without individuals first. So, of course, in a way, this is like the biggest and oldest debate in all of social sciences, right? Actors versus structures, and where does it lie? And, of course, the social scientists will say it's both together, right? But then again, where do we put money first, and where do we start first? I agree. Does this tell me anything about it? Frankly, to me, it ran counter to my intuition, I must say. It increased my sense that Howard and Steve were right, so to speak. Because I also had it around issues of development. Mark hinted at this, the strong sense of Burundians, of their individual responsibility and the individual features that make people capable of making it in life versus others not. It's really deep. So at the very least, all I can say is, if this is how people think about it, we better face up to that. Maybe we don't need to do everything differently and sort of drop everything with structures and just find the right people and look them deep in the eyes and say, I love you, what do you need? Maybe it's not that, but at the very least we got to face up to it that this is how people themselves think about it. And maybe we are neglecting, and we have been very afraid for years, certainly we technocrats in the World Bank, but even in more sort of smaller places that are maybe less technocratic, many of our NGOs that were initially born out of religious impulses, isn't it? And that have, however, totally moved away from much of this. It seems that these things of individual responsibility and character matter an awful lot, and they drive a lot. And they drive how people judge things, how they wish to be treated, how they behave towards things. And maybe we have underestimated it. So I agree with you. Huh? I am not about to throw it all away, structural work, in favor of individuals only. Neither would they. They saw themselves as contributing something to a broader dynamic that was also structural. So at the least it would say, maybe we got to think more at both these planes, at both these levels, and be more willing to fund guys like them.
Yeah, nice of me. Hey.
I know.
But you've earned your plug. That's
the activism question that you ask, I actually don't really... It's hard to say. I do not have the impression that most of the people I met felt themselves as having the power to change things in the structures around them. They may have, however, dreamt about it. They did desire it. They did judge how they were treated by the state and the system. They did judge that very negatively, and by politicians in general. There's a yes. But I did not hear much of a sense that they could do something about it or were doing something about it. No. But there's probably an unmet demand for opportunities to do that, maybe. But not yet much of a supply of that. That's all I can say, sort of improvising here right away on this issue. Yeah.
Mark, any insights?
Well, I'm going to speak just briefly about Rwanda, and then a couple of things that Peter, I just noted that Peter, comes from Peter's comments about just our overall approach in the region. On Rwanda, activism is an interesting question. I mean, a lot of my team interviewed really a significant number of officials, and they were really reflective and expansive, almost everyone, about the issues of youth. And they're aware of the fact, which is one of the most prominent findings in the research, is that there is without question, there's a housing crisis in Rwanda, and it's of much greater significance than education to nearly all youth in the country. And particularly up to the sector level, people are aware of that. So I don't know. The problem is that policies are being, created at the national level, and there doesn't seem to be a way to break through this from the level of government officials. At the same time, there was a concern. I mean, I think a lot of what goes on with youth in both countries has nothing to do with the government. And so, some Burundians would say, look, if I go to the government, especially kind of these cranky lower-level guys, they're just going to arrest me. So you can't. Activism means, is kind of dangerous. A lot of people would say, "Well, I didn't go to the gachacha. Why is that?" Well, just act like I didn't hear. Especially like a female youth. Who notices if she's not there, even if it's mandatory? Nobody. So there was a lot of sort of pulling out of things. There is an institution called the National Youth Council. That is goes all the way down to the cell level all over the country, which is the problem is this class issue. It's really seen by undereducated or non-elite youth as something that educated youth do, and so they, why would they go? So in the officials are unemployed, the secondary school graduates, and what are they supposed to do? They're volunteers, they're not trained, and how are they supposed to broach this anyway? It's a very, very tense. There's a great deal of suspicion of educated youth. They feel with a widespread idea that they're going to be swindled if they try to work together, that the educated youth, they have education, so they can take advantage of us. And I think that class issue is really a telling one. Two things about that I think resonate from both of the studies is with you know this idea that Eric and Paul bring out about a development. I think one thing that we know is that the traditional ways of getting information about what goes on in a country have major gaps, and I think in both countries, the difference between what we found with really extensive qualitative research with members of the majority were, I know the Rwanda case, spectacularly different than the findings of most of the studies that are costing a lot of money by major donor institutions. So there's a gap there, and I think in terms of, it's hard to devise, to craft appropriate policies unless you know what's really going on. So I think this approach that we tested out has a tremendous amount of value for people. And let me point out again, it was the World Bank that was their idea, let's do research on youth in a qualitative way. The last thing is, and this is something that I was just looking over Peter's book last night again, and it really reminded me, is that for most of the youth that we interviewed in both countries, there really wasn't a statement. There wasn't much evidence in either country among youth that there was much direct engagement, exposure to international agencies of any kind. That's in both countries, rural areas and urban areas. So this institution building idea is not reaching the majority. There's no question about that. And in my experience, most particularly and profoundly in the urban areas. Those are they're the most immediately aware, but as Peter points out, you know, they're not getting assistance or recognition.
Yeah, so. I do want to follow up on that last point. Very important in Burundi too, to me, was the neglect of the urban area in terms of opportunities. It's partially related, I think, to an image of the countryside as Burundi being a rural country, which it is not anymore. There are many, many links there, and for many rural young people, the key is to make it to the city, and many do, and there's almost nothing out there. There's no microcredit, there's almost nothing out there. Yet those same cities are chock full of potential danger. I mean, if there is places that are truly dangerous in terms of conflict, it is obviously the poor neighborhoods in the city. Even, for example, the World Bank's big Pradex, which somebody mentioned here earlier, does not work in the city. It's kind of surprising. So, and another one was, there truly is, and I was blown away by this, a sense of vertical mobility is possible in Burundi. I thought the answer would be the poor stay poor and the rich stay rich. And no, Burundians frequently, many of them told me stories about vertical mobility. Downwards was very, very easy to achieve, by the way. But nonetheless, they knew and talked with respect about stories of upwards mobility. Do you see him there? He used to start with one pant on his shoulder, and now he has that many pants, he even can't carry them on his shoulders anymore. He had to build a little stand there. I mean, I would hear these stories over and over. And I think anything that can create a sense to young people that it can actually be done, that you can make it. And this is actually what a bank originally is about, right? Creating macroeconomic growth. But an opportunity is very, very, very powerful stuff. And foremost, of course, in cities. And maybe even targeted. But I would say targeted, if you, for example, had limited resources, which obviously you do have, then you might wish to start in places where the highest hotbeds of radicalism exist, which in my experience in Burundi at the time were either the IDP camp, because young men are profoundly unhappy being there. They really, really, really are imprisoned in their minds, and their Tutsi notice. And in, say, popular neighborhoods like the ones where I worked in Kamenge, where many self-demobilized, i.e. former soldiers who had left the military movement before the demobilization package and hence get nothing. Now, those were some of the angriest young men I had seen. Imagine you targeted at those places microcredit and opportunities, which not all will avail of, but which give a sense that it is possible for some to make it. That could be very powerful stuff. So you could sort of use what you do normally, but targeted at particular areas, and hence try to get rapidly kickstart stuff in the right places. So there are ideas possible, I think. Yeah, that's all I wanted to say.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Peter and Mark. This has been a fascinating morning. I think they'll probably be around for a few moments as we exit for any further private questions. But let's join in thanking both of them for this wonderful presentation.